Oh, well, let's see if we can get this part two out there, because we had to recharge and plug in. We was getting a sign on the recording apparatus that we was low on time and might have lost the entire first part of the message. Hopefully we've been able to preserve that. So we're going to deal with the second part of the message right now. This particular message is speaking to the Church of Philadelphia, and we're addressing the African-American roots of Rastafari in this hemisphere, bringing to light once again the first church of Rastafari, which was established in Louisiana, New Orleans. The half of the story that's not told. Some people believe that, well, Rasta and Rastafari is Jamaican. It's Jamaican reality. And what we're demonstrating and showing is that this is not true by several works coming from the 1920s and the 1930s, written by African Americans to enlighten the African American public and population to the true light of Rastafari, of His Imperial Majesty Kadamawi Haile Selassie, that was shining in the world at that particular time. And now, what the Holy Spirit has directed us to is Revelation chapter 3. In Revelation chapter 3, we have the message to Philadelphia at verse 7. And the true church and the professing church. Now, we've explained that the true church and the professing church, first of all, is that Negro, the Negro spiritual, the African-American, the soul church, the black church. Within that black church, there's a true church, and that true church is the Church of Rastafari. And the first Church of Rastafari was established during the 20s and 30s in Louisiana, New Orleans. So Rastafari is not just a Jamaican thing, as many people would believe. That's what the media, that's what the hype, that's how they seek to divide and conquer us and deceive us in the media. Rastafari is an Ethiopian Hebrew reality. It's a biblical scriptural reality. It's a manifestation of that new name that we're about to touch on here in Revelation chapter 3. So in Revelation chapter 3, to review, let's go over this once again. It says, "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia." Philadelphia means brotherly love. It says, "Write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is kedus, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth." Now, it's important for us to note that His Imperial Majesty is the only known king who's on a throne, who sits on the throne that's known as the throne of David, that has legitimate roots with the people of the Bible, which is the only true throne of David in the world. And the throne of David is a real reality. The reason why some have not heard about it is because they don't know the real facts about Ethiopia, a book written by J.A. Rogers from the 1920s and the 1930s. We also touched on this book written by a Reverend Sterling M. Means. Let's give you the title page right here. He has a picture of His Imperial Majesty on that particular white horse. And over here is the title page. You understand the title page, Ethiopia and the Missing Link in African History. As you can see, it's by a Reverend Sterling M. Means. And this is not the only book that was written by African-American reverends and preachers and pastors who were able to see prophetically that light shining from the east to the west, as the Bible predicted, as prophecy fulfilled, as Christ himself said, as our black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ himself said. So let us continue with this right here. That's just to emphasize the Davidic connection, the black David connection, in other words. Verse 8 says, "I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name." Verse 9, "Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews, Ehud, and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship," or bow down, prostrate themselves before thee, before thy feet, "and to know that I have loved thee." There's also a fulfillment of this with the black Jews of Harlem and our first Black Rebbe or Rabbi Wentworth Arthur Matthews. Also, there is Rabbi Josiah Ford, Arnold Josiah Ford. He's the one who wrote the Ethiopian anthem that was used by the UNIA, so forth and so on. Now, this Marcus Garveyism needs to be clarified and put into its proper context, because before Garvey, there were these African-American preachers who were that true church in the professing Negro or black church, who were declaring, look to the east for the crowning of a black king, where a black man will be crowned king. In him, you will find the Redeemer, our prophetic kinsman Redeemer. Because when we put our identity into context, that which would open the freedom for us biblically, scripturally, from the curse into the blessing would be through that kinsman redeemer. And Haile Selassie I of Ethiopia is that kinsman redeemer. Now, in verse 10 it says, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I will also keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Verse 11, behold, look and see, I come quickly, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown, that no one takes our crown. Verse 12 is significant now to understand the new name of Ras Tefari, and that manifestation, you understand, that manifestation through the true church in the professing church. And in particular, the African-American connection, or the Ethiopian Hebrew Falashas of the West connection with the true Ethiopia. Verse 12 says, him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem. That New Jerusalem is the African Zion, the African Zion, which is the true Ethiopia, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, from Elohei, Elohai, Elohai, from Amlake. And I will write upon him my new name. So here in Revelation chapter 3, verse 12, Christ is saying, in your red letter Bibles, you can see this very clearly, in your red letter Bibles, if you look at that in the red letter Bibles, it shows us very clearly, this the red letter is Christ speaking. Right now, if the red letters is Christ speaking, Christ, Jesus Christ, whom the book is revealed from and through now John, the disciple and apostle John, or Saint John, Caduce Johannes, Yah's grace, he says right here, I will write upon him my new name, that new name. So Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, we know that name, but he is saying that he will have a new name. So ask your Christian preachers and pastors, what is that new name? It can't be a name already revealed, because he says, I'm going to write upon him my new name. You understand? Jesus Christ in that day, in that time, was not the new name. It was a name he was known by, but now he is revealing something that is shortly to come to pass. You understand? In the seven ages of the church. Now here in the sixth age of the church age, which is called Philadelphia or brotherly love, he says, I will write upon him my new name. Now, the Rastafari have properly and rightly declared that new name is Rastafari, Kedemawi Haile Selassie. That new name is Rastafari. This is why it says in verse 13, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. So it's not a materialistic message to the churches. It's a spiritual message. This is why many folks, many Christians, many pastors and preachers don't get this message, because it is not a material message, a materialistic message. You see, they've turned apostate. They've fallen away from the true good news of the King of Kings and His Christ into a prosperity gospel, into a pseudo-prosperity message, which is a counterfeit. You see, that's a counterfeit gospel. That's a counterfeit message. And that's not the true message of this scripture. If any book in the Bible should be taught and preached to the people, especially in the so-called black churches, it is the message in the book of Revelation. but without having a proper context. You see, what they don't have is the proper context. And these documents help to put things into more proper context, from Babylon to Timbuktu. You understand? A history of the ancient black races, including the black Hebrews, as well as the Valley of the Dry Bones. The Valley of the Dry Bones, the conditions that face black people in America. And we're talking about today, what's going on today. This book, written in 19 and published in 1988, is even more relevant today with our first African-American president, especially today as we're on the cusp of 2012, than it was in 1988. If one couldn't see the sign in 1988, they should be able to see the sign in 2011. If they can't see the sign in 2011, then they are blind. You understand? And if they are blind, they're going to stumble on. And if you follow the blind will lead the blind, and both will fall into the ditch. This message, my brothers and sisters, is a very important and a very, very timely message. As we said in the near the end of the first part, that we were a little bit low on our battery power and the recording. So what we're going to do is pause for the cause right here, my brothers and sisters, and say Shalom Rastafari, and stay tuned for more to come, Yah willing. Yahai, Yahai, Jah live, children. Yay, Awo, and Amen.